today we're going to do sort of a show and tell kind of sermon. We're going to smash up the children's sermon and the adult sermon, making a sermon that is for all of us at once. So as we look at the Gospel of John, the first chapter, I want us to think of it a little differently, to have a couple new ways of looking at it to help us through. So I want us to consider a blueprint, a pointing hand, baptism, and a magnifying glass in order to more fully understand the Gospel of John. Let us pray. Lord God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Lord God, may the preacher decrease that you might increase. Amen. Now, the thing to begin with is the Word. In the beginning was the Word. Now, there's a lot of ways to dig into what this word thing in the Greek logos is all about. And one of the metaphors that I think is helpful for understanding what word meant in the ancient world is a blueprint. This is a blueprint of St. Stephen Luther. It has, multiple pages. You have stuff about the land, you have stuff about the electronics, you got stuff about water, all kinds of different plans that help you construct the whole thing. Now, when we talk about the word logos, translated as word in English, it is similar to a blueprint that the word is more of the word is the thing itself, or it's a way in which we can get to the thing. So, for example, when you say pastor, there's this word that means me, but it's not me. It's a word, it's an ideal pastor out there. Because I'm clearly not an ideal pastor. Now, in this case, the blueprint of St. Stephen here is the ideal in the architect's head about what St. Stephen will be. But then, of course, you get the actual building, it's a little different, that kind of thing. So, it's the ideal up there, the blueprint. So we're going to replace logos, word, with blueprint, just to get a different feel for the Gospel of John. Obviously, this is not sort of universal. This doesn't crack John's meaning of the start of his book, his Gospel. But it helps us at least get a different flavor and feel for what he's saying. So, in the beginning was the blueprint. So this is God's ideal world, God's ideal life, God's ideal creation of all that is, seen and unseen. And also, though, because humans are a big part of creation, Paul at least takes this and moves forward with it to talk about the second Adam, the new Adam, that this blueprint man, the ideal man was not ideal in as we go forward in Genesis. So, in the beginning was the blueprint. So, God's ideal world, as well as the second Adam. All these kind of crammed together. The ideal human being, the ideal world, ideal creation, was there in the beginning. And the blueprint was with God. Well, that makes sense. An architect needs a plan, right? Whenever you see them wandering around, they have a T-square under one arm and a blueprint under the other, and they're going along. Likewise, God has his plan as God creates. And the blueprint was God. And think about this. The blueprint is, in some ways, as close as you can get to the inside of the architect's head, right? That's the building that ends up getting built is one step removed from the blueprint, which then is as close as you God, but there is a little bit of the divine sort of floating around in there. Not something that we're trying to capture and, you know, go after for salvation or something like that, but that God is there in especially the blueprint, if not the actual creation as it rolls out. The blueprint was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. Quite simply put, you don't have a blueprint, you can't make the thing. What has come into being in him was life, and that the life was the life of all people. So Jesus, as the blueprint of life itself, so on one hand, by our very vivifying nature, we live and move and have our being, has to do with Jesus, with this blueprint. But also, on the other hand, it's a blueprint for how to live. That both of those are kind of interplaying there, at least a little bit. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome. So, the blueprint, the ideal of the thing, and the thing itself, are there together in the same room, and the imperfect version of the thing doesn't overwhelm it. So, for example, St. Stephen Luther in this church right here, it has the blueprint inside it, and yet the blueprint is not overcome by the building itself. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. Then secondly, we talk about John a little bit. Now John doesn't claim to be the blueprint, but instead points to the blueprint. John gets this wonderful experience of knowing that the Logos, the Word, the blueprint, the ideal, the real, is there in the world. But he doesn't sort of lord over people with that knowledge instead. He points to the thing itself, to the blueprint, to the word, to this blueprint that enlightens what we here in creation ought to look like. So he points, that's the point here. John the Baptist points to the Logos. There was a man sent from God, his name was John. He came to witness, so to see, and to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify, to point to. He came to testify, to point to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He's pointing to that fact. Then thirdly, the Gospel of John declares, we are children of God. One of the things to think about when you think of a child, yeah, is that the child is born. It's not as if it's working hard to be born. Instead, the mother is birthing this child. It might be rough stuff for the mother, but it's simply a gracious thing for the child. I think whenever I talk about grace, one way to think about it would be being birthed. That it's not us coming into the world, but instead our dear mother birthing us into this world. So, he was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God. There will be birth. Children of God who were born. We don't do much to get born, we just sort of, it happens to us. Not of blood, or the will of the flesh, or the will of man, but of God. We receive this Logos, and in doing that, by recognizing, being recognized even by this blueprint of the world as it ought to be, but is not. We're born of God. So one way to think about it, as Lutherans we talk about our baptism. In our baptism, we become children of God. So always remember that. You are a beloved child of God, and no one can take that from you, because it has been given to you from God. We've been born from God. And that cannot be taken away. So it's important to remember our baptism. Because you, brothers and sisters, you, each one of you, is a beloved child of God. Then one of the cool things about the Gospel of John, this first chunk, is that it then reviews everything that is pointed out. So first off, but then it goes on, and the blueprint became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. So you got a blueprint. And it becomes flesh. Think of this being a fleshy blueprint. That would be weird. We would be like, hold up, that's not what you do. That's not what a blueprint generally is. So too, in the ancient world, when they're told that the Logos becomes flesh. That's a strange thing. That's at least as strange as having a blueprint made of flesh. But the point being that the blueprint's there. So the blueprint became flesh and lived among us. It's a weird statement, but it reminds us of the connection between the blueprint and God, but also God and us in that. Now, John pointed to him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, he will come after me. He who comes after me will rank ahead of me, because he was before me." So John is constantly pointing to Jesus, pointing to the Logos, pointing to the blueprint made flesh. From his fullness we have received, so much like birth, we receive it. We have received grace upon grace. We receive it as a child receives birth. Not something they earn or do, but instead something that happens to them and they go on living in it. Then finally, the fourth chunk here. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God's only Son who is close to the Father's heart who has made him known. So it's the idea of the invisible God becoming visible in Jesus Christ. So I have a magnifying glass here to point that out. So, for example, I can't really see my fingerprint very well, but with that I definitely can. With the magnifying glass, I can see what was once invisible becomes visible to me. So too, God becomes visible to us in the person of Jesus Christ, who John points to, pointing us towards our birth as beloved children of God, pointing to Jesus, who is the blueprint made flesh for our sin. Amen.